Warm greetings to everyone. I am Vidya Kamakshi, a PhD scholar at Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee, India. I am here to present a work that we have jointly done along with Uday Gupta and Narayanan C. Krishnan. The title of our work is PACE, which is Post Hoc Architecture Agnostic Concept Extractor for Explaining CNN. So let's get started. In the deep learning era, we do see that neural networks give state-of-the-art performance in almost every task. But they cannot be readily applied everywhere due to the simple reason that they are black boxes. That is, we don't understand the internal working of the neural networks. So there is this field of research called explainable AI, abbreviated as XAI, which aims to peek into the internals of the black box. So our work is also an add-on in this area. So we try to generate explanations for the working of the black box such that they are human interpretable, and we try to generate it in a way that it is faithful to the internal working of the black box. So coming to the literature available in explainable AI, they can be broadly categorized into two methods, post hoc and anti hoc methods. So in a post hoc method, you don't perform any modification to your black box model. You try to tweak into the internals of the black box and generate an explanation stating which are the features which are integral towards the prediction. Whereas in an anti-hoc model, you try to make some modifications to the architecture and create another model where explainability is incorporated by design during the training process. So, because of this, in anti-hoc model, the faithfulness is guaranteed, whereas the accuracy retainment is a challenge. While in post-hoc, as there is no modification to the black box model, accuracy is retained, whereas the challenge is in getting a faithful explanation. So our work is a post hoc model where we have integrated the concept of faithfulness by design. So here is a sample explanation from our framework. So this is a test image. This has been predicted as an elephant. So we try to extract the concepts that are integral towards the prediction as well as give the relevance. That is, how relevant is each of the extracted concepts towards the prediction. So in this image, you can see that there are these two supporting concepts of face and trunk, as well as an inhibiting concept of trees. We can see that trees is a concept that is not specific just to this class. It can be present in any image. Hence, it is an inhibiting concept, whereas the support from these two concepts, face and trunk, has led to prediction as elephant. So this is how our explanation looks like. So this is the architecture diagram of a framework. We can insert a framework at any convolutional layer of interest. We extract the feature maps from the convolutional layer and process it through the encoder decoder as well as the concept vectors which are integral parts of a framework, and extract the concepts that are integral towards the prediction of a class. So we will go through each and every component of our architecture in detail in the upcoming slides. So the first component of our framework is the encoders. Our encoders are linear 1D convolutional layers, and hence they are interpretable. We have a dedicated encoder for each class. These encoders extract the embeddings from the feature maps. So these embeddings denote the manifestation of a concept in the given image. But as well as we have something called the concept vectors for each class. So these concept vectors denote the abstract representation of these class discriminative features. So here is an illustration to demonstrate the difference between embeddings and the concept vectors. So you can see there are two images of lines. The orientation of the line is different in both the images, as well as the concept highlighted here is the mane of the line. Because of the difference in orientation, we can see the appearance of mane is different in both the images as well. So the embedding vectors may appear different for these two images, whereas the concept vector abstract out these differences and captures what exactly is the essence of something called mane. So this is an illustration to demonstrate the difference between embeddings and concept vectors. So given that we have concept vectors and the embedding vectors, we can find the similarity of the embeddings at each of the spatial location with respect to the concept vectors. This gives us the similarity map, which will later be used for visualization as well as further concept analysis. So we have the similarity of our embedding with respect to each of the concept at each location. So we can detect how strongly a concept is present in that spatial location by thresholding this similarity value. So the locations wherever the concept is strongly present, the most similar concept that is strongly present in that location is chosen, and the corresponding concept vector is replaced in that location in place of the embedding vector. This gives us the concept maps, which is passed through the class-specific decoders to get the decoded concept maps. And these decoded concept maps are passed through the black box, and we note the probability of the corresponding class K. This is done for all the classes, and we concatenate this probability to get the explainer's predicted probability distribution. We would enforce a match between this explainer's prediction as well as the black box prediction in order to ensure that our embedding as well as the concept vectors are to lie in the same data manifold. So now comes the relevance computation part. So this is one of the key thing in our framework, that relevance computation is integrated during the learning process. So this is done by mimicking the absence or removal of a concept. So at locations wherever the concept is strongly present, we replace the embedding vector by means of a zero vector, denoting the removal or absence of a concept, and we follow the pipeline, and we note the drop in probability as a result of the removal of this concept. So this drop in probability is what is called the relevance metric. As this metric is incorporating the black box into the pipeline, this is faithful by design. Let's see some of the concept characteristics and how we are actually realizing them. So basically, we wanted our concept vectors and the embedding vectors to lie in the same manifold. So this is achieved by means of different loss functions. So the first is the triplet loss that is applied at the embedding space. So we wanted our embeddings to be clustered such that the embeddings corresponding to the same index are closer to each other at different images, as well as they should be far apart from the other concept embeddings. So for each of the concept, we determine the embedding that is closest to it at the given image. So we have this collection, and we take this specific embedding of interest as our anchor, and its corresponding anchor positives are the embeddings of the same concept index at different images, whereas the negatives are nothing but the embeddings across the other concept indices. So given that we have the anchor positives and anchor negatives, we apply triplet loss as suggested by Scroff et al. So the next loss component is to ensure that the embeddings and the concept vectors are aligned in the same data manifold. So we enforce a cross entropy loss between the explainer's prediction as well as the black box prediction. So the third loss component is applied at the concept vector space. The concept vectors are to be far apart from each other so that they can represent the distinct concept. So to ensure this, we are maximizing the total pairwise concept vector distances. The final loss component is for the relevance computation. So we want the concepts that are extracted to be highly relevant to the prediction. That is, by removing the concept extractor, the drop-in probability has to be maximum. This is enforced by minimizing the mean squared loss between the relevance and the explainer's prediction. So the overall loss function is nothing but the weighted combination of these individual losses. We have used the Adam optimizer to perform an end-to-end training where the components of our explainer, which is nothing but the parameters of class-specific encoders, decoders, as well as the class-specific concept vector representations are learned. To the best of our knowledge, ours is the first framework where class-specific concepts are extracted in a post hoc manner. To compare the efficacy of our framework, we propose a baseline where the main components of our framework are mimicked by means of standard techniques. The encoder-decoder component where the linear transformations occur is mimicked by means of a standard dimensionality reduction technique, CCA. To mimic the presence of concept vectors, we perform k-means clustering in the latent space learned by the PCA transformation. But the catch here is, it's not possible to learn class-wise clusters if we just apply PCA. So we adopt a different training strategy. We form pure batches where all the instances in the batch are predicted to be of the same class K. Please note that we are using the label as predicted by the black box and not the ground truth label, because we want to learn the working of the black box. From this pure batch, using the PCA, we learn to extract the embeddings. So these embeddings are clustered by means of k-means clustering to get the C cluster centroids, which denote the C concept vectors. Given that we have the necessary components to mimic our PACE framework, we follow the pipeline just as how we would follow in PACE framework to get our explainer's predictions. We get the prediction from our PACE explainer, baseline explainer, as well as from the black box. We denote in how many cases is there an agreement between the prediction from the black box as well as the baseline explainer, and similarly the agreement between the black box and the PACE explainer. We denote this as agreement accuracy, which is tabulated here. The higher the metric, the better is our faithfulness. We can see from the table that our PACE explainer significantly outperforms the baseline explainer in all the cases. So this is our quantitative comparison. So now we will discuss about the qualitative experiments, that is human subject experiments that we have performed to evaluate the efficacy of our framework. So we have conducted concept tagging experiment, that is for a given concept index, we have generated visualizations corresponding to some random 5 images. We showed these visualizations to the human subjects and asked them if they are able to see a consistent pattern being highlighted across all these visualizations. If yes, we asked them to provide a tag denoting the concept that is being highlighted. So this measures the consistency and interpretability of our explanations. So here is the table where we show some of the tags that are given by the human subjects. We were able to see that 72% of our extracted concepts were human interpretable. So here are a few visualizations of the different concepts and the tags given by the users. We can see that they are indeed the discriminative parts which help distinguish the animal from others. So here are some uninterpretable concepts. You can see that the area being highlighted is so small that people with great attention to details were only able to interpret these concepts. Given that majority deemed it uninterpretable, we have labeled it uninterpretable concepts. So these are the visualizations corresponding to the birds. So here as well, we see that the concepts that are extracted are indeed truly discriminative to identify the specific bird. So this is the main advantage of our framework, as we have class-specific concepts. We are able to analyze the misclassifications and explain why a specific instance has been misclassified. So here are a few examples in this slide. So you can see an image of a collie, which is a type of a dog, which is being misclassified as a horse. So if we visualize the concept that has the highest support towards prediction as the horse, we were able to see that that was a concept corresponding to the mane of the horse, which is nothing but the hairs present in the horse. So given that in this particular image, much of the hairs of the collie is visible, this was misclassified as a horse. Similarly, we can see an image of a German Shepherd, which is being misclassified as a hippopotamus due to the presence of water. And here is an image of a cow, which is misclassified as a ox due to the presence of horns. So our black box model was wrong, but it was wrong for the right reasons. We were able to make this analysis only because we were learning class-specific concepts. So to conclude, we have proposed a framework where we can learn class-specific discriminative concepts. The relevance definition that we have proposed ensures that faithfulness is integrated by design. Our relevance computation is integrated into the learning process. We have experimented on 2 different data sets and 2 different architectures to show that our approach is architecture agnostic. So our qualitative and quantitative experiments show that our proposed framework PACE was significantly a better framework. Thank you.